so much for joining us, Mr. Sanjay. It's a privilege and an honor to have you here with us. And I won't take a lot of time introducing him because it's best if you can hear from him. He has so many wonderful things to share, truly inspirational, truly motivational. Mr. Sanjay, I'll leave the stage to you to share how mental health integrates and is a part of a sports person's life, and how you personally as well dealt with your diseases that you had to go through in the later part of your life. Over to you.
I have played badminton for India for almost 16 years. I was captain of the Indian team at the 1989 Asian Championships and the 1990 Commonwealth Games. I have played international badminton almost every country in the world. And I've been coach of the national team from 1998 to 2003. And commentator, TV journalist, TV commentator, journalist, writer, and author. Now, mental stress and sports. It's a very interesting topic for me because I have seen children and parents who come along with them to, you know, to put them in sports and all this, and they get upset and get stressed, and then they bow out of the so-called sports arena. So let me just go through what I call as the problems that the parents face first, and how the parents themselves become a problem for the children, and how better they can do to cope with it. Now, first of all, if you want to keep your child in sports, you have to search for a coach. In my time, there was no coaching. So we were just observing and learning from our senior players, and, you know, quietly and meekly stand in one corner and tell him, sir, ye backhand zara mere ko sikha do, zara forehand sikha do. If they were in the right mood, they would give you 2 minutes, otherwise you had problems. So first and foremost, you have to get the right coach, which is not easy and not simple. Because the badminton boom that has come now because of Saina Nehwal and PV Sindhu, you suddenly find that everybody is a coach. People who are holding the racket wrong have become a coach because there is such a dearth of coaches. 20 years back or 15 years back, for example, there were just around 20 courts in Hyderabad and about 40 courts in Bangalore. Today, Hyderabad boasts of 500 courts and Bangalore has probably got about 700 courts, Bangalore and surrounding areas. So you can imagine the requirement for a coach, because the parents do not know what is to be done, but they want to put the child in sports. So important thing for you is to, first of all, identify the coach. Has he played to certain level? And has he represented his district or state or the national team? If he has, then you can go to him because he knows what he's talking about. Or it has to be a certified coach by the Badminton Association of India and the Sports Authority of India, because he's done the diploma, 2 years diploma, so he knows enough of the game. So that is very important that you get the right coach at the right time. And very often I've been asked, because I've been coaching since 1982 till about, I'm still coaching. The one thing that parents ask me is at what age to put the child in sports. There is no relevant answer to this. You can have a child playing from the age of 3 or child playing from the age of 13. All it depends on how they learn and how fast they improve. So the first and foremost stress for parents is to find out a coach who are more interested in taking your money and, you know, for the month, and then they're interested in the welfare of the child. You have to find a coach who has got a profession and a mission. His mission is to produce champions. His profession is, of course, he is giving you time, so he has to earn by it. But it's a rare combination, and you have to be after the coaches to find out what is the best way out. Second is, once you have started, your child has started playing, what level you want him to play or her to play, where does he end up, and how much is the stress he's going to face because of studies? Because as far as the coaches are concerned, he has no say. So we come to the stress caused because of studies. Now, my answer here is very simple. As one of my students and my good friend Pulela Gopichand says, who is the chief national coach for the last 10-12 years, I have incidentally written his authorized biography, also called The World Beneath His Feet. If you find time, please take it and read it, and you will learn a lot on how the coach's mind works. So Gopi has what you take your child to him for coaching. The first thing he will say is how interested you are in studies. So as a normal parent would say, yes, study is very important and blah, blah, blah. And Gopi will say, I am not here to give studies to your children. If you want to become a professional badminton player, I'll help you out. But if as far as studies are concerned, I will not compromise. Simple, into the face answer, and he's absolutely right. Because today, in today's world with competitive sports and prize money going up and up, you have to have enough time to the game from whatever time you start. And if you do not give that enough time, then it is waste of time for your child to get into any sports. Gopi is very clear about it. And you can imagine, if you are reading about sports and you follow badminton, that he has produced a huge number of world beaters within some 6-7 years of his coaching. He's really iconic and really a legendary coach. But he's very clear that if your interest lies in both, he will not take you. If your interest lies in learning badminton, then you come to him. I will give you a small example of Saina Nehwal, who in my opinion is probably the best female athlete the country has produced till date, taking all disciplines into account. After writing Gopi's book, I was interested in doing something on Saina. So I approached her father, Harveer Singh Nehwal, who is a director with the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, and he's a PhD in seed. His specialty is seeds. And I asked him, I said, Harveer Sahab, aap to itne padhe hue hain, PhD wagera kara, aapki ladki ne to 10 saal ki hai, 12 saal ki, to usne aage padhai chhod diya. So he says, my dear chap, I may be PhD, but Saina is MBBS. She's MBBS in badminton. And what she has learned and what she's earned in the last 3 years, I will not be able to do it in my lifetime. So then he said, you know, he says that, you know, she grew up so fast because of sports, that usko to gudde gudiyon se khelne ka waqt hi nahi mila. So bachpan bhi chale gaya uske andar. But look at what she has performed and how she has lived her career. And he's absolutely right. So from the age of 10, she was putting in around 4-5 hours a day. And by the time she was 13, she was a national junior champion. By the time she was 18, she was world number 10. 19, she was world number 2. And then eventually she became world number 1. Now, most, if you have some knowledge about the business world, it's very interesting to see that people like Bill Gates and his other friends, Steve Jobs and all, they were all college dropouts because they had a passion and then they went after it, and what a career they made. I'm not saying that you study or don't study. What I'm saying is you have a choice. Pardon me. If you are able to study and do this two sports together, other activities together, you're most welcome. But you will find it very difficult to excel. Top players in India, for example, Sachin Tendulkar, Leander Paes, Saina Nehwal, Sania Mirza, and all gave up studies by the time they were in 10th. Because then concentrated only on the sports career and see where they have come. Best batsman in the world, Leander Paes is a tennis legend, Saina is a badminton legend, and Sania is a tennis legend. So that is the way one looks at things, because your time should not be divided between this side or that side. So if you want to study, you study. If you want to play, you play. In my coaching career, the first and foremost questions that the parents ask me by the time they come to the child comes to the 9th standard, sir, abhi 10th mein aa gaya hai, board exam mein bhi to game band karna padega. But aap ek bar game band kara doge, saal bhar ke liye to 3 saal piche ho jayega. Wo aap nahi sochte ho. So, but they don't listen. So 10th mein he takes 6 months break, and 12th he takes 6 months break. And then he's over as a player. So you have to be very careful in as far as the studies are concerned. If you feel that a child has to study more, then you please make him into a doctor or an engineer or a PhD, then sports is not for him. But if he has to excel in sports, then there is direct competition, and it's to be successful is quite rare, then you have to take your own call. So the study stress should not be brought on the child if you want the child to do well in sports. That is my opinion, and not only mine, but even Gopi and other coaches in different games. Now I come to the parental stress. Now, why parental stress? It's very simple. Are you the right parent to put your child in sports? You have to ask yourself first. And do you know what it entails to be a successful parent? I can assure you from my own example that there is no social life, no kitty parties, and no family marriages that you can attend if you intend to put your child in sports. Very rarely you'll get time off to go and visit these people. I've got about 11 cousins situated in Allahabad and Mathura. I could not go for even one marriage. And they were all upset with me. They would not speak to me for years. But my problem was that, what do I do? I got to play my game. I cannot miss my training. I cannot miss my practice. But if I go to Allahabad, the Mathura, or wherever the marriage is taking place, I will not be able to do any of these things for next 7-8 days. And my diet will go to the cleaners. Everything will change and I have to start all over again. I simply could not take a chance, so I did not attend any marriages. After I retired, my elder daughter started playing international tennis and she was very good at it. So I had to take her all over India and neighboring countries. And same thing happened again. Some marriages were there when I was taking my daughter Medhi around. And I could not attend the marriages. So they said, first you don't attend because of your career. Now you don't attend because of her career. But we are caught in a trap. There's nothing much you can do about it. So you have to ask yourself whether you can give time to your child, whether you can, your social life goes for a toss. No kitty parties, no nothing. You are involved with your child all the time. So that is something you have to ask first before you put your child in sports. Now, the other thing is, whenever child is playing and losing, you don't have to come up with a classic cliched sentence, "Are tumhare upar itna paisa kharcha ho raha hai, tum haar rahe ho." That is not on. A child doesn't go into the court wanting to lose. He goes into court wanting to win, but he may lose. It's all part of sports. The question is, what does he learn from losing a game or losing his practice, and what do you have to do about it? You are not an expert. You've hired a coach. Let him deal with it. You're not an expert, so do not go and do backseat coaching or backseat driving. Let the child be on his own. Let the child enjoy the game first. Enjoy competing first. And then he will himself or herself will find an answer to giving a good performance. If he is not giving good performance and the coach says that let us go and see a psychologist, don't shirk it. Go to a sports psychologist. There are so many different fields of sports that have opened up, which were not there during my time. A sports psychologist can guide you, can tell you where you're going wrong and what you should be doing to make sure that your child is having the motivation to do better and better. But so never go to the court and start giving coaching from backside because your coach will be involved in some other court with another child. It's very important that a child should not be told that you are not thinking about the expenses that are going into your game. We are sacrificing so much and yet you're not performing. That is not on. So that gives a lot of stress to the child. So it does not. So no coaching from outside, I've already said. And the child must be told, primarily by the coach, that you play to satisfy yourself. Do not play to satisfy me, that is the coach, or satisfy your parents. You play to satisfy yourself. It's very important that right from beginning we understand these things. So that is a parental stress that parents have to be very careful about. If you do not have it in you, you cannot give your time to your child. Your parties are more important. Your socializing is more important. Then please do not put your child in sports because he will or she will lose her way out. I come to the traveling stress. Sports is not cheap. Sports is getting more and more expensive. So we have got, not only you play tournaments locally, you have to play a lot of tournaments. So you should have deep pockets. You should be in the initial stages. In today's expenses and inflation, I reckon you'll have to put in around 30,000-40,000 rupees a month to get a good coach, good practice areas, and your traveling expenses to go to the venue. Now you got to play 6 to 8 tournaments in a year as a junior. If you want to do something and get a ranking in the Badminton Association of India's national ranking, you got to play 6 to 8 matches when you're under 15 or under 19. And it costs a lot of money. See, the traveling is there, the hotel is there, the food is there, the dieting is there, the transport is there. So all this is part of the traveling stress, as they call it. If you're not up to it, if you find that I've got to cut corners and start something, please don't put your child in sports. Now, only cricket, for example, is the only sport or a discipline, or I actually call it a business, where you can think of taking up the game as a career. Not in any other sport so far. Badminton is doing well enough, but you will be, it is only one or two people who shine, become national champions or runners up in the category two, good enough money. Otherwise, nobody else is there. So you got to keep that in mind. And if, in spite of all this, you want to get into sports, then please go ahead and do it, because, and I don't want to frighten you by stating all this which I've stated above. It is pure and simple from my experience, what I've seen. It's very important that you know the right way and the right path, right coaches and everything before you take a call. But having said all this, I still feel that sports is still the best thing that can happen to you. Keeps your body fit, therefore you are mentally fit. There is a personality development in sports. You become nidder as you walk onto the arena and hundreds and thousands of people watching you, and you play a match. And you have to be immune to the catcalls and this and that, and you concentrate on your job. So you learn to be self-reliant. And it is very important that you also become an instant thinker on the court, because it doesn't give you much time to start playing well. So you got to be instant. You got to give. You got to play the right strokes at the right time, and you have to play not to win the match, but to play to the best of your ability. So never think of the next round or the next tournament you're going to play unless this one is over and you're giving it your best. So sports keeps you fit. Sports has a personality development. You become self-reliant. You start thinking in terms of that, you know, one loss is a loss yesterday, but today is another day, tomorrow is another day, I'll come back fighting. And one other thing I want to add here is, why sports is so nice and so, for example, I've always maintained that there is no nepotism in only one field of your life, and that is sports. Doctors, engineers, and all these people, the people owning business and all, can have their children coming into that field, and they get a ready-made platform to do well in life. But sports is the only place where there is no nepotism. You are your own king, and you've got to do what you have to do when you fire says love all and start a match. Now, one example I give to my students is simple, that I have a match against Bill Gates, who was the second or third richest man in the world, and still is. And Bill Gates comes to the court in a Mercedes, best of equipment, two people holding his water bottle, chocolates, banana, what have you. He's wearing the best of the clothes. And I come on my bicycle with my one jhola on my shoulder, with my two rackets, shoes which have been, which I've seen the mochi for, because they phat gaye, they seal diya hai. And the umpire says, love all. And I win. So when we go back, he goes back with a stooped shoulders, and I go back with my chest, shoulders held high. Talking about my Parkinson's and my cavernoma, a double whammy in a way, and after the operation, I lost sensation below my waist, and I was in tears, as you can imagine. A sportsman of my reputation caliber, suddenly I was without sensation and feelings in my legs. And but the main thing was that even though after the operation I could not even wiggle one toe of my legs, it took me around 7-8 months of heart physiotherapy and this and that before I started walking with the walker, and I started coming back. And the surgeons, my neuro director surgeon Dr. Abhay, both told me it is because of your sports background that you've been able to come back to such an extent, because otherwise we would have thought it would take at least about 4 or 5 years. But because you're a sportsman, your body was fit, so you're finding it pretty easy. So that happened to me, and I'm sure that other people, other the sports can give you that sort of feeling that I will conquer this. I'm not going to lose out. It's a very important feeling that you have. Once you have this feeling, once you have the answers, you will go ahead and undertake any operation or surgery and all this, they become irrelevant. And I must also share with you that I was doing extremely well, and about a month and a half back, I fell down in the bathroom, fractured my left hip. I have just got a left hip transplant done. And I was in tears because I did not know what was happening. But I'm coming out of it, and I'm going to fight it like I fought the other battles.